Hello, and welcome to TI Precision Lab Series on Current Sense Amplifiers. My name is Peter Elia, and I'm an Applications Engineer in the Current and Position Sensing product line. In this video, we will discuss how to read and interpret Current Sense Amplifier datasheets. Let us begin by addressing the overall structure of the standard integrated circuit datasheet. The first four sections comprise the front page, which allows the engineer to quickly determine if the part is relevant to their application. The next major section is the specification section, which we will spend the majority of time breaking down. The detailed description and application sections are the textual components to the datasheet to allow for in-depth understanding. The front page of the datasheet allows the reader to quickly determine whether a part could or could not work in their system. Aside from key electrical specifications like offset and IQ, the front page for Current Sense Amplifiers, or CSAs for short, can contain key functional descriptors. Some devices are best designed to sense at relatively stable common mode voltages, in which case they are low side and or high side capable. Other devices can have the ability to accurately sense current while the input common mode voltage, or VCM, is switching rapidly. This is referred to as inline sensing. A unidirectional device is one that can only sense current flowing in one direction, while a bidirectional current sense amplifier can sense current flowing in both directions across the shunt resistor. Analog bidirectional amplifiers will most always have a reference pin that allows the output voltage to be offset, usually to mid-supply. The absolute maximum rating section, or abs max, are the limits beyond which permanent damage may occur. For current sense amplifiers, the most critical rating is usually the input common mode voltage rating for the input pins. The voltage at the input pins cannot go beyond the rating specified, even for very short events, or else the device can be permanently damaged. Note that the common mode voltage rating is not representing the standard definition, the average voltage of the input pins. This rating pertains to the individual absolute voltage at each pin. The recommended operating conditions detail the range of conditions the device is designed to operate within. These conditions will always be more limited compared to the absolute maximum ratings. Before detailing the specifications individually, let us address the structure. Specifications are broken up into two sections: the parametric table and the typical datasheet plots. Each will have their own global testing conditions listed at the top, which detail how the device is tested unless otherwise noted. The difference between the table and the plots is that the specification table will list typical and maximum specification values. The typical specification value normally covers plus or minus one standard deviation, or plus or minus sigma on a Gaussian distribution of a single test population. This means that roughly 68% of the device population will be less than the typical value. For some parameters, typical specifications may represent the mean value of a distribution. The maximum and minimum specifications can be referred to as limit specs or max specs, and are more important than the typical. Max specs are guaranteed at their testing conditions shown. They can be guaranteed through test, a statistical characterization, and/or design. So for this part and its specifications shown, you will never find a device with an offset greater than the maximum of plus or minus 25 microvolts, given the device is operating with the exact same testing conditions. It is important to note that the typical characteristic plots represent a one-time characterization of a single device or population, manufactured around the time of the device's release. Because of this, the true center of the distribution can vary slightly over time due to process variation. However, the maximum and minimum values do not fluctuate, as these can be screened for during final testing. This is why it is important to always use the max specs when performing an error analysis. Continuing along with the specification table, specifically the input section, we see the many common specifications reported in most amplifier datasheets. Note that the common mode voltage is independent of supply, and it is tested over temperature. So regardless of a system's operating temperature, the worst case CMRR of 120 decibels should be used when calculating a total offset. While some specs may not dictate it, all of the error sources, such as CMRR, drift, and PSRR, should be considered input referred, unless otherwise stated. This allows for the easy calculation of a worst case input offset when performing an error analysis. Note that when the conditions list VSense equaling zero, this means that the inputs are shorted together. This is seen with the input bias current spec. One key takeaway from these specs is that the lowest guaranteed offset error will occur when the device is operating at the global testing conditions. Since CMRR, PSRR, and offset drift could be positive or negative, the addition of their respective offset errors can always yield a larger offset voltage. Simply put, if the device is operating at the global testing conditions, then additional offsets from CMR, PSR, and drift will not be generated. Next is the output specification section. Since gain error dominates as sense voltage increases, this section provides the device's baseline error. A current sense amplifier family can have multiple gain variants. The real gain will deviate from its typical value. Using two data points and calculating the slope, or the device's true gain, a gain error can be established. For this example, once the output voltage drops below 50 millivolts or exceeds the supply minus 200 millivolts, then the gain error of the device can begin to deviate from the specification. For more information, consider watching our gain error video. Specific to the INA240, there is another error listed in the datasheet called reference divider accuracy. This specifies the absolute error in the reference voltage created by supplying a reference when driving both REF1 and REF2 pins to separate voltage levels. Note that this is an offset error and not a gain error, since the testing conditions show VSense equal to 0 millivolts. Another offset error here is the reference voltage rejection ratio, or RVRR. This specification works the same way as CMRR and PSRR in that as the reference voltage deviates from the testing condition of VS divided by 2, there will be some change in the offset. Lastly, a common spec for many CSAs is the maximum capacitive load with no sustained oscillation, which says that the INA240 should not drive a purely capacitive load greater than 1 nanofarad, especially over temperature. Once again, a key takeaway when studying these specs is that the lowest guaranteed gain error will occur when device is operating under its testing conditions, which include the global and that the Vout is within its specified range. The next specification section is for the voltage output. These are the swing-to-rail specifications, and they do not necessarily determine the linear region of the device. Rather, they detail the physical operating capabilities of the device's output stage. The specified linear range is ultimately determined using the testing conditions for gain error, as seen in the previous slide. So let's explain the meaning of this spec. Swing-to-power rail, or VSP, shows how close the output voltage can swing to the VS rail. This is accomplished by overdriving the input with a voltage beyond the full-scale range of the device. The swing to ground, or VSN, conversely shows how out can swing to the ground rail by overdriving the input with a voltage below the full-scale range. In this example, since the VREF equals zero for the testing condition, a VSense of negative 10 millivolts will slam the output to ground. The third specification is the zero current output voltage, or VZL, and it can be helpful in understanding where the output can start when sense current is 0 amps, or essentially when the inputs are shorted. Note that the VZL is not always specified, and that sometimes VSN is specified with VSense equal to 0 millivolts. So be sure to always check the testing conditions. If needed, VZL can be approximated by calculating the worst case offset and multiplying it with the worst case gain. Lastly, note that each specification shows a 10 kiloohm load resistor to ground, which means each specification is tested at a single output current. While discussing the output swing specifications, it is important to understand the relationship to the typical characteristic plot of output voltage versus output current, or what can be referred to as the claw curve, due to its resemblance. Let's start with the VSP spec. The VSP spec is determined by overdriving the input and measuring Vout. The output current, or Iout, can be calculated by Vout divided by the load resistor, or RL, which is 1.8 volts divided by 10 kiloohms, equaling 180 microamps. But what happens to VSP when the output load is higher, creating a larger Iout? This is in fact what the claw curve shows. By connecting a variable load to the out pin and simultaneously measuring Vout, we can characterize how the swing specs change as Iout increases. The top curves represent sourcing Iout currents, which flow out of the out pin. The relationship is, as sourcing Iout increases, so does the VSP. The bottom curves represent sinking currents, which flow into the out pin. The relationship is, as sinking current Iout increases, so does the VSN. Overall, the more current the amplifier is required to drive, the less output dynamic range it will have because its swing-to-the-rail capability will decrease. The last section of the parametric specifications are frequency response, noise, and power supply. The specifications shown are for the INA293, which is a unidirectional amplifier, so it has no reference pin. This means its input will require some DC bias voltage to offset the amplifier into the linear region when determining small signal AC analysis. This is also shown in the testing conditions with DC input voltages that are scaled according to the device variance gain. The AC input VSense is not specified, but it should be assumed to be a small signal, so somewhere in the range of 1 millivolt to 100 millivolts, depending upon the device's gain. Slew rate for CSAs is always referred to the output, and by definition, slew rate is a large signal analysis parameter. Settling times are a function of bandwidth and based upon small signal analysis, while device output is in the linear region. This can be confirmed with the testing conditions listed as plus or minus 0.1 volt step on top of a 4 volt output bias. Note that if the device was bidirectional and had a reference pin, then the input bias voltages would not be needed for these specifications. Voltage noise density is always referred to the input and considered broadband. Similar to operational amplifiers, noise density can be modeled as a voltage source at the N plus pin of the CSA as shown in the schematic. The power supply requirements are straightforward, but note that the IQ, quiescent current, could vary depending on the common mode and supply voltages. In order to determine more specific behavior, the engineer must study the typical characteristic plots. That concludes this video. Thank you for watching. Please try the quiz to check your understanding of the content. For more information and videos on current sense amplifiers, please visit ti.com/currentsense.